crooked road to get where I'm going, to get where I'm going. I walk a crooked road, and only when I'm looking back, see the straight and narrow, see the straight and narrow when I walk a crooked road. Sing a lonesome song to anyone who listens, to anyone who listens. I will walk a lonesome song, and I hear you singing too. Sorrow sounds so hopeful, sorrow sounds so hopeful when I sing my
Good morning. The Bible says that let everything that have breath praise the Lord. She started us out right this morning to praise the Lord. I love to hear her sing and just so thankful to have her this morning. We are so glad to see each and every one of you all this morning. And we welcome you here. We welcome those online. We welcome you. And we praise the Lord today and always.
Want to give a special welcome to my friend Mackenzie. Mackenzie was a second or third grader when I met her, and some things haven't changed. So we've been friends for, I don't know, however many years that is, that's math, and 30 years. And so I'm always thankful. She comes once a year to Lewisburg and helps me lead worship music. So we're so thankful to have her. I want you to look on the back of your bulletin. There's a pepperoni rolls and popsicle next Sunday right after worship. You can exit either of these two doors and you'll see out there a table full of goodies. Hope you'll stick around on the corner and just speak to one another and say hi and eat a popsicle or a pepperoni roll and just enjoy some time together as you exit as a time of fellowship. So we hope you'll stay. If you'd like to make a donation of an item, on the Can You Help table, there's still some things we need so we can have this fun event. So please stop by there after worship and sign up to bring something. Finally, we want to give a special, special thank you to Toni Hughes. As y'all know, she's been doing an internship here for over two and a half years. Thankfully, she's sticking around. She and her husband and family will still be part of our family at Lewisburg United Methodist, but her internship is wrapping up on July 1st as she had the opportunity to sort of explore ministry and kind of enjoy learning all the bits and pieces. And so she'll still be plugged in here, but she won't be in an internship. So I want her to say a word, and then I want us to give her a big thank you.
I'm clapping because I've enjoyed my time here under Reb Bev. We've had some good times. We've laughed and cried together. I've learned so much from Reb Bev, and so many of you have just been just so loving and so kind and have, you know, reached out to me and let me know that I have touched your lives in some kind of way. And about the Holy Spirit in and not afraid to clap or say amen or hallelujah. I hear them every now and then, and I think, God, my work was not in vain. So I thank each and every one of you all. I will be plugged in. You'll see me in and out. I'll still be in ministry and still studying under, there's other pastors that have reached out to me. So, but Bev has got first choice. I will be here for her when she needs me. So y'all pray for me as God sends me on to something new. I could have taken a church, but I just did not feel ready. I did not feel like God called me to be a pastor quite yet. So I'll still evangelize, and I'll still work on it. And who knows, one day I may be a pastor somewhere. So continue to pray for me. Lift me up. Call me, text me. Bev has my number. If you want to get in touch with me and do lunch, I love to do lunch, you know. And that way I have a captive audience. So call me. I'd be glad to do lunch or dinner with you. You can invite me over too. I mean, y'all be blessed and know that I am thankful for LUMC and Rev Bev. And you all.
Well, the weather has been hot and muggy recently, so you're going to turn and you're going to tell the people around you that if you're a hot weather person or a cold weather person.
You may be seated. You may be seated.
You tell them what we're doing, Kylie.
So today we're going to continue our interviews, and I have up here with me my amazing dad. Can you tell us your name, please?
I'm Kylie's dad. No, actually, my name's Adam Criddle.
All right, will you tell us and describe to us where you grew up?
Well, the first 13 years of my life, I lived in Kanawha County in a city called South Charleston. And then my family moved here in 1984. So for the last 40 years, I've been able to say that Lewisburg was my hometown.
All righty, what's your biggest fear?
Well, before this morning, I would have said that my biggest fear would to be interviewed by my daughter in front of the church family, but it's not that bad. So if you do get asked to participate, don't turn it down. But I think I'm going to try to hold it together, but I think my biggest fear is not being able to walk my two daughters down the aisle on their wedding day, so I'm hoping I'm able to do that.
We didn't practice, we rehearsed. So.
Alrighty, and how do you describe God in one word?
For me, it's almighty.
Alrighty, give my amazing dad a round of applause.
Hearts to worship. I'm going to read Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Sing along with us. This is my story. This is my song.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Will you stand with me and we're going to sing together soon and very soon. As the children come forward to spend some time with Tina, we're going to ask that you sing to them This Little Light of Mine, and we'll just keep singing that till they make it all the way up. Let's begin.
This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine.
Good morning, everybody. How are you? It's summertime. What's one of the favorite things that you like to do during the summer?
Go to the beach.
Go to the beach. What's your favorite thing to do during the summer? Do you like to play outside? Yeah. What else do you like to do? You like to play in water? Go on trips? Do you like to roast marshmallows? That's one of my favorite things to do is roast marshmallows. And you know, it's better if you do it at nighttime around a bonfire. But sometimes I'm afraid people might not see me when I'm roasting that marshmallow. So I wear a necklace, a very special necklace that glows. See? It's glowing. Well, it's supposed to. Darren, can you turn out the lights, please, and let's see if it glows. My necklace isn't working. I might get lost in the dark. Do you know how I might fix it to make it glow?
Turn it on.
Okay, let me twist it. Not working. What if I hit it? Nope, that didn't work.
Shake it.
Shake it?
No. Ooh, it's
like a maraca. Ooh, what if I bend it? Maybe? That's amazing. All I had to do was break it or open it. So you know what, let me tell you the trick to a glow stick. So there's liquid inside, and then there's a glass tube in the middle of it. And then when you bend it, you break the glass tube inside. And then you shake it up, and the two mixtures mix together to make it glow. Did you know that? Did you know that? Now you learned something at church today. All right, so it's a glow stick. You know what? You can turn the lights back on, Darren. Thanks. And it's still glowing. I won't get lost. Yay. You know what? This glow stick reminds me of the Bible. Can you believe that? The glow stick is like a Bible. What is the Bible? Do you know what the Bible is? What is the Bible?
It's a book about God.
It's a book about God. It's got lots of stories in it, right? There's different kinds of Bibles. There's this one that we keep in our pew. This one is a kid study Bible. And it's got that. Here is one that's a day by day that you would read each day. Words are a little bit bigger. If you look up there, there's a huge Bible. Do they all look the same? No. But they all have the same stories in it. But you know what? You know why this is like a glow stick? It doesn't really do anything if we just keep the Bibles in the pew or we keep these on the shelf. We need to actually break them open like I broke the glow stick and look inside at all the stories. There's lots of stories about God and all of his disciples. I want you to think, what's one of your favorite stories in the Bible? Can you think of a story from the Bible? Jesus walked on water, that's right. What's another story that we could find in the Bible? What?
But it's not my favorite.
Oh, okay. It doesn't have to be your favorite. Just tell me one.
There's a bunch of blind men ones.
Okay. All right. Does it tell about Jesus' birth? Yeah. And it also has a story about how Jesus died and has all kinds of different stories. But the important thing is we can't just keep the Bible all closed up. We need to break it open and read all the stories in it. Pretty cool. Just like my glow stick. And if you read and break it open, you're going to glow with all the knowledge of Jesus, and you're going to be the light. Pretty cool, huh? All right, let's say a little prayer, and everybody can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, and thank you for the Bible. Help me to remember that I need to take time to break open the Bible and read your word. And learn all about the stories you have. I love you, and I know you love me too. Amen. Thank you very much. Guess what? You get a glow stick too, but I'll give it to you in the back after you collect a noisy offering. Let's go.
Light of mine.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
One more time.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine.
Far away.
Yeah.
New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher place that I have. Lord, put my feet on higher ground. My where doubts arise and fears dismay, though some may dwell where those abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith in heaven's stable land, a higher place that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on
reading of the scripture. The scripture for this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 20, verses 7 through 11. And it says, "On Saturday evening, we gathered together for the fellowship meal. Paul spoke to the people and kept on speaking until midnight, since he was going to leave the next day. Many lamps were burning in the upstairs room where they were meeting. A young man named Eutuchus was sitting in the window. And as Paul kept on talking, Eutuchus got sleepier and sleepier until he finally went sound asleep and fell from the third story to the ground. When they picked him up, he was dead. But Paul went down and threw himself on him and hugged him. 'Don't worry,' he said, 'he is still alive.' Then he went back upstairs, broke bread, and ate. After talking with them for a long time, even until sunrise, Paul left." This is the word of God for the people of God.
We should have called this message maybe more of just a devotion, because we're just going to share the story with you this morning. I cannot believe the stories in the Bible. You can't make this stuff up. I want you to raise your hand if you actually have heard this story before. Anybody? Oh, there's a few of us. It's kind of wild, isn't it? Before we kind of crack on this guy who fell asleep in church, raise your hand if you've ever... No, I'm kidding. Before we crack on him, I think we got to know a little bit about him. I want to recap the story for you. It started by saying they gathered together first, before this very long sermon, for a fellowship meal. I don't know about you, but when my belly gets really full, I love a nap afterwards, don't you? So not only was his belly full, but it says it was crowded. Everybody came to hear the good news of Jesus Christ, and so it would have been warm. It said it was on the second floor, right? Or the third floor, up high? Third? Okay. Hot. No air conditioning. Belly's full. It's warm out. Then it says, Paul spoke to the people and kept speaking until midnight, since he was going to leave the next day. In other words, Paul droned on and on into the late hours. And then it says, Eutuchus got sleepier and sleepier. You know that feeling where you're trying to fight it, but you're just getting sleepier and sleepier. I think we also need to know a little bit about his story. He was young. It was commendable that he would even show up. As you know, finding young people that want to engage in worship and faith is a big deal, and he showed up. The history is they understand that possibly he was a slave at the time, which means he would have been so weary from all the tasks and all the demands of his master, but he still showed up. Maybe that's the lesson in the story, that sometimes, even if you're weary, just keep showing up. Yes. In the book of Galatians, I love the scripture that Paul himself actually says. He says, "Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. So then, take every opportunity. Let us work all good toward all men, and especially toward them that are in the household of faith." It's just a simple reminder that we've got to keep showing up. Whatever is wearing you out, yes, God sees that you are showing up, and he will honor that. When I was in college, one of my favorite things that I took away that I learned in college was just this simple idea that you should never bore someone with the gospel. Never bore someone with the gospel, because the gospel is life-giving. It is alive. It strengthens you. It's life-changing. It's transformative. It's all grace and truth, and it sits in your hearts, and it's the hope that this world has. There is a reason that Jesus over and over again told stories. He knew people would pay attention better to a story than anything else. He told stories because it related to people's life. He told stories because he wanted them to remember the takeaway. There's only a few times in all the stories of the Bible where Jesus got angry. And every time he got angry, it was because someone was boring someone with the gospel and telling them this false message that not everybody is included in God's grace. Remember when the disciples told the children, "No, you can't come see Jesus right now. He's tired. Don't bother him." Jesus fussed at the disciples and said, "Oh, let the children come to me." He did not want the children excluded. How about the Pharisees? He'd get angry at them all the time. Those were the good church folks that would always show up for church, but then during the week didn't act like church folks. Those were the ones that triggered him the most. And then finally, I think about the temple. Y'all all remember that story where he goes into the temple and they were selling all kinds of animals for sacrifice. And some people thought, oh, well, that means you shouldn't do any fundraising and you shouldn't ask people for money. That's not why he flipped the tables. He flipped the tables because they were charging such a high price. He knew who would be excluded: children, widows, the poor, those that were lame and broken and didn't have the funds. He wanted everybody to be included, to hear the good news. And so he never bored anyone with the gospel. So my sweet friend Mackenzie will tell you her takeaway on the story.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Bev never put me to sleep in a church sermon because she wants to go to lunch. So timing is of utmost importance. So I'll do the same because I learned the best from her. But I'm so glad that you guys get to share all of your worship experience with her for 30 years. As we mentioned, we've been friends. So, yeah, and it's been, we sang a song about a crooked road. I feel like the glow stick, Tina, was super appropriate because Bev printed it out as Broken Road, and that's not the name of the song. But there is something to say about that, is that I feel like you keep showing up, whether your road is crooked or broken, and you will find your way to a loving, grace-filled Jesus and community. So I grew up small town Weaverville, where I met Bev. She's probably shocked I'm alive. I like brought a pocket knife to Vacation Bible School and got kicked out. I was in camo clothes running around picking on all the kids. I was a terrorist. It was church. I grew up there. My family had come for years. I was third generation going to that church, and I kept being forced to show up. As the years passed, I made a lovely friendship, learned a lot about a grace-filled God that isn't there to exclude people. And so it didn't matter how many times I said a bad word or dropped a pocket knife on the playground, she let me come back. time passed in life, and I went off to college, and we kind of didn't get to keep up as much as I would have liked. And I had my own faith journey and struggle then. I tried to be very by the book. I was going to, Wednesday night services and Sunday night services, and pushed it in one direction for me. Came back, Bev and I caught back up at her three-point charge she had in a little town where my family's from, and we started playing music again, and all of a sudden I'm back in church and enjoying it in a way that I never got to experience. So instead of saying I'm just not coming to your place because it makes me uncomfortable or it's not doesn't fit me, I showed back up and tried again, and that plugged me back in there. Then she headed out of town, kicked it, and left me. So I came back to another church and continued to play music with some friends, and that was a totally different kind of church. It was a large church like yours, and my faith journey got really askew at that point. I was just busy with a new career, getting married to my wife, had a kid, and I needed to plug in a way that was more tangible and real for me. And so I said, I'm going to go to this place we call Haywood Street in Asheville. And it is a mission-based church. Doors open at 7 a.m. and anybody off the streets can come and sleep in the pews. We feed folks lunch every Wednesday and Sunday, have a sermon. And the service is a conversational homily is what they call it. So like your pastor would like pitch a question out and folks would tell their own stories. And sometimes that guy was drunk in a corner telling the story about how he got his wallet stolen the day before on the street. Or a mom stands up crying in prayer time because she can't get her kids to school in time and get them breakfast. And, you know, it got really raw and real there. And so it still isn't the most typical church situation, but I showed up there and realized that, like, Jesus and his grace can be found, like, anywhere. And it's often in the coolest places when there are people that aren't usually included and have a hard time fitting in that you really get kind of rocked about what Jesus looks like. And so that's where I'm at today now. I run the board there and do I build their affordable housing. We're going to be housing about 120 people in Asheville's first fully deed-restricted affordable housing complex in the area. So we've moved from, you know, pews and food all the way to trying to get people in some homes. And so you just keep on until you kind of plug in. And sometimes you're going to be in those, like, I know it's so cliche, the valleys where you feel like you're not getting a lot done and not really connected. But God has a crooked road for you, but it'll get you where you're going. Now love with all my heart, there's no way of stopping. I have no way of stopping. I'll just love with all my heart. Through the broken and the beautiful, the bad news and the good news, the bad news and the good news, I'll love with all my heart. And a loving heart will be my true companion when all else has abandoned for loving on their own. And a loving heart will feel my day's gladness, make joy of the sadness, and bring my loving heart to you.
We want you to respond to what you've heard and seen this morning. There are ways to, in the back, that you could light a candle, or also here, use the altar for a moment of prayer, or use your own sacred space to talk to God.
Go. When the rain is blowing in your face, and the whole world is on your case, I could offer you a warm embrace to make you feel my love. When evening shadows and the stars appear, and there's no one there to dry your go hungry, I'd go black and blue.
is nothing that I would do to make you feel my love. I know you haven't made your mind up yet, but I would never do you wrong. I've known it from the moment that we met. There's no doubt in my mind where you belong.
Hear the prayers of the people.
A big thank you to Mackenzie and the Rigglemans for our special music this morning. Prayers for Karen Gwynn and continued strengthening. The family of Herb Montgomery, Marie Goodwin, Roger Taylor, who's having heart and kidney problems. Continued prayers for Arletta Jackson and Harold McMillian. Prayers for Jacob Kessler and his family. And prayers for those in Iowa and Kansas who have been affected by flooding. And prayers for all of the unspoken prayers here in the sanctuary and online.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's something about your name, Jesus. Oh, Lord, as we lift up your holy name this morning, we give you praise. Lord, we ask you to bless, Lord, and keep those. Jeremiah 29:11 says that you know the plans that you have for each and every one of us, God. Plans to prosper us and not to harm us. Plans to give us a hope and a future. And we thank you, Lord, for that. Lord, we lift up those to you on our prayer list, God. Those that are sick and shut in. Those that are bereaved. Those that just need your presence, Lord. Oh, Lord, we pray for our world, God. And we pray for our country. This is your world, God, and we know that you're in control. And God, you will return someday. Lord, we ask you just to lead us and guide us and direct us, God. God, we ask you to help us on our journey just to be a light for you and to draw all men unto thee. And God, we praise you today. We praise you and we lift you up. We thank you for this church that's the light on the hill, God. And God, we ask you to help us to reach out to the community and help those in need and help those that don't know about you to learn about you and your love. We thank you most of all for your grace and your mercy, God. And God, we just continue to praise your holy name today and always. God, we love you. God, we just praise you over and over and over. God, we're grateful for everything that you do for us. And God, we know that if we look towards you, our help, we know that our help comes from you, and we appreciate everything that you do for us, God. You're a loving God. You're a kind God. You're a compassionate God. And God, we're going to always lift up your holy name and praise you today and always. Amen.
Prepare for our benediction right after our musical benediction song. There is a 1-minute video that explains to you what it is on the back of your bulletin. It's called Lighthouse Congregation. Thankfully, Lewisburg United Methodist is already such a welcoming place. When you come to Lewisburg United Methodist, you're going to be greeted and you're going to be shared with other folks. We're going to introduce you to folks. But some of the churches in the United Methodist Church of Greenbrier County are closing, and so we want to be a lighthouse church, which means that we are welcoming to those that have come from other congregations that maybe their church is no longer going to be meeting. So we want you to know what that is, and so we're going to show you a video clip right after the musical benediction for those that would like to see what this is all about, that we are a lighthouse congregation. So let's stand for our musical benediction, which is I'm going to lay down my burden. When you're ready. Okay.
I'm going to lay down my burden.
Lighthouse congregations are local churches in the Western Pennsylvania Conference that are particularly equipped to welcome anyone whose church has closed or disaffiliated and who wish to remain in the United Methodist Church. These congregations will act as a resting place for those seeking a new United Methodist faith community, with people who will care for and provide a haven of peace and grace. Lighthouse congregations will serve four purposes. The first is to provide a welcoming place to belong during this time of grief and transition, which might be for just a season or for a lifetime. This includes a safe space with caring relationships, listening hearts, and unconditional love within a congregation that is confident it is remaining in the UMC. Secondly, Lighthouse congregations will offer pressure-free ministry opportunities in which to engage. These opportunities may happen through worship, discipleship, mission, and other ministries. The third purpose is to proactively find and connect with individuals and groups displaced by disaffiliating churches. And finally, Lighthouse congregations will connect individuals or groups with conference and district resources to help them discern their next steps towards finding a church home. The motivation behind Lighthouse congregations is not to increase membership numbers for specific churches. Rather, our goal is to make sure United Methodists are cared for and sheltered during a time of transition. As individuals consider what is next, specific pathways from which they may choose will continue to emerge as the conference, districts, and local churches come together to be the connection at its best. In the meantime, Lighthouse congregations will be there to welcome those who need a place to rest.
Hi, I'm Rev Bev with Lewisburg United Methodist, and we are in the middle of Creative Camp, serving about 120 students. Ministries like this happen because of your continued and faithful giving. If you would like to make a contribution or an offering or a tithe to our church and the vibrant ministries that happen here, you can do that in the following ways. You can mail it to P.O. Box 69 in Lewisburg. You can drop off your offering in the worship sanctuary on Sundays at 10 or in the church office. And of course, you can also give online by going to our webpage or through Facebook. We again are so thankful that things like this can happen, serving others because you are serving the Lord.